Students, welcome back to our online classes. Myself Rekha, and I'll be taking SS in your class. And today's topic for our class is Chapter 9, Religious Movement. And you all know that we are going to study the medieval period in the SS throughout your 7th class. So now, medieval period is very important from the religious point of view, because many religious movements, they have occurred during this period. And the religious movement, it can be grouped into two movements, that is the Bhakti movement and the Sufi movement. And both the movements, they had the same objective, that is to encourage people not to indulge in the complex rituals. Now, what do you understand by complex ritual? Complex rituals means what? Like performing some pujas, or following some vrat, or you are doing some havans. So all these are coming under the complex rituals. So the saints of Bhakti, okay, they composed hymns and the same bhajans glorifying the God. They said that instead of following such rituals, you can sing God songs which are related to the God, and you can perform your bhakti through that. In the same way, the Sufi saints also, they devoted their bhakti through the music. And that is why both the saints, they advocated for a simple life. That means you don't have to indulge in the complexity of the life, but you have to lead a simple life. And in this chapter, we will study about some important movements which occurred in the Sufi and Bhakti movement. Now, the first one we are going to study is the Bhakti movement. Now, the Bhakti movement, the advent of the Bhakti movement took place in the 18th century. Means advent means what? The meaning of the word advent is arrival. So, the arrival of Bhakti movement, it started in the year, in the century, 18th century. And the two saints popularized it, Alwar and Nayanar saints. And what they came from the different castes, and they followed a different profession also. Plus, what they preached, the path of surrendering oneself to the God. Means you have to completely give yourself to the God. And when you give yourself completely to the God, that time only you can achieve a bhakti movement. Okay. And these saints, what they did, they traveled from place to place singing songs and hymns related to the God in praise of God. And then whichever the places these saints have visited, the Chola kings, they built the temples. Means which places they went, the Chola kings, they built the temples of Alwar and Nayanar saints. Okay, whichever the God, they were singing songs and praising the gods. The next part is Bhakti saints. Now, which all saints were there in the medieval period who helped this Bhakti movement grew? So, during the medieval period, Shankaracharya and Ramanuja, two saints were there, Shankaracharya and Ramanuja, they spread the Bhakti message in the South India. Especially in the southern part, they have spread the message of the Bhakti. And Shankaracharya, he believed that there is no difference between the soul of the God and the soul of the human beings. Means, there is no difference. Like the purity, basically what he meant is that the purity of the soul of the gods is similar to the soul of the human beings, and the way to the salvation is only through the knowledge. Salvation means what? It's completely like you have to. Salvation means it's a path that leads a person towards the God. So it can be achieved only through the knowledge. That means you have to have a proper knowledge that what all things are there. If we are doing those things, then only we can lead towards the God. That is by doing our good deeds. And Ramanuja taught people to put themselves completely in the hands of God. You have to give yourself completely in the hands of the gods. And that by loving God and by doing good deeds, only could the soul be saved. He considered the bhakti to be more important than knowledge. What Ramanuja said, that bhakti is more important than acquiring knowledge, or you are having whatever the knowledge. And with the passage of the time, the bhakti movement, it spread to the other parts, and the saints, they preached the message. Whatever the message was there, they wanted to give to the people, they gave it in their local language or the regional language. For example, in Maharashtra, Namdev, Tukaram, Janeshwar and Eknath, these all saints, they popularized bhakti by worshipping the Vithala. Okay, Vithala is the incarnation of Lord Vishnu, and through that they devoted their bhakti. And in the Krishna. And Meerabai, a Rajput princess, was also a devotee of Krishna. She composed numerous bhajans expressing her love and devotion for Krishna. And it is said that Meerabai, she was, you know, a true devotee of Krishna, and she was given completely herself in the bhakti of Lord Krishna. The next topic is teachings of bhakti. What all the bhakti saints have taught us? The first point is that devotion and selfless love are the means to come close to the God. Means if you are loving someone, let it be a human being or any other living being, you have to love them selflessly. Plus you should be having your pure mind and pure heart, and that is very important in the bhakti. And plus closeness to the God, it cannot be found by performing some ceremonies, like if you are performing some rituals, your havans or all those things. So that cannot lead us to the coming close to the God. But if you want to come close to the God, then the very important thing is that you have to be completely give yourself to the God, and by the devotion and selfless love only you can achieve that. And the second point is that all the human beings, they are equal. That means no one is above or below. God has not created low caste people or the high class people. He has not created any Hindus, Muslims, Christians. So people should be tolerant to one another. That means we all are human beings. Nobody is high or low. Nobody is belonging to that caste or that caste. So everybody is equal. And the third thing is that we should have, you know, we should feel the pain of others. Instead of increasing the pain of others, we should try to lessen it. And plus, helping fellow human beings is a true form of bhakti. Whenever anybody is in the trouble, we should try to help them. Instead of, you know, giving them some pain, we should help them. And the next point is that knowledge is an essential part of bhakti, and it can be gained through a teacher. So whenever you want to have a knowledge, you should have a teacher. Through teacher, that is a guru, you can achieve a proper knowledge, and guru only can lead you to the God. He can show you the true path through which you can come close to the God. And a devotee can express bhakti through devotional music. So whichever the songs are there, whichever the hymns are there, only through that you can express. Then the next topic is the death of the Kabir. That is, when the Kabir died, that time he was having both the Hindu and Muslims as his disciples. And according to the legends, when Kabir passed away, that time there a dispute arose between Hindus and the Muslims. Muslims wanted to bury the body of the Kabir, and Hindus, they wanted to cremate the body. But what happened, when they took away the shroud, that time they did not find any body of Kabir, but they found some few flowers lying over there. And what the Hindus did, they took away some flowers, half of the flowers, and they cremated them. And the Muslims, they took away half of the flowers and they buried them. And the followers of the Muslims, the followers of the Kabir, they are called as the Kabir Panthis. What are they called as? Kabir Panthis. Now, the next part is the work of the Kabir. What work did Kabir do? Kabir never wrote down anything. Means whatever the things he was saying, whatever the philosophy was there of the Kabir, he did not write down anything. Plus, he preached his followers through short poems called dohas or couplets. Whatever he wanted to teach to his followers or his disciples, he was teaching it through the dohas. Like you must have heard the dohas, okay? Plus, we know about the teachings only from the oral traditions. Whatever the Kabir had taught us, we know about Kabir's work only through the oral traditions. Means whatever the followers, they used to pass it from one generation to another generation. And like that only we came to know about the work of the Kabir. And after the death of the Kabir, his work was written in the Kabir Vani. Okay, whatever the words were there were of Kabir, it was written in Kabir Vani. And plus, Kabir Granthavali and Bichak, in these two books also, whatever the work is there, whatever the philosophy of Kabir is there, that is mentioned in that. And the next holy book is Guru Granth Sahib. In this book, there are 500